Good morning, everyone. Glad to see you here this morning. Hope you didn't have any trouble getting here. You did not. Hope you don't have any trouble going home. I was kind of ahead of the weather. I didn't hit any rain at all till I got south of Hodgenville today, so it was good. And decision was made early on that we will observe a normal schedule this morning with our 9 o'clock worship service. Tonight is church and business meeting. That will go on as scheduled. The weather will be well out of here. I want to ask you, how many of you all are pondering being here on Christmas Eve at our 5 o'clock service Christmas Eve? Lots of hands going up. Let me invite you. We're doing something different this year, and some of these behind me, this beautiful choir, some of them are hearing this for the first time, perhaps, but we are going to have a Christmas Eve presentation, somewhat like a Gaither homecoming Christmas. And what we're going to do is present very familiar music that all of you know and that certainly all of you all know, and we're going to weave memories and the message of Christ throughout the evening. Now, what does that have to do with you? We would love to see on Christmas Eve at 5 p.m. a full choir loft even beyond this. We've got about 30 up here today. I would love it if some of you all that are out there that love Christmas music so much, if you would come and sing with us on Christmas Eve, and I promise you, you're going to know the music. So ponder it. Mark your calendar. 5 o'clock on Christmas Eve, we will begin. If you were here last week and you got a worship bulletin, you know that this has been a week of prayer for international missions and Lottie Moon. So I want you to turn your attention to the video screen again as we watch a video regarding the Lottie Moon offering for Christmas.
How can I make sure that what I do as a physician demonstrates the love of God and the mercy of God and the hope of God? From an early point in my childhood, I can remember watching the first moon landing on a black and white TV and thinking, I want to do that job. So I just pursued that. And then was able to get into an aerospace medicine residency program to work for NASA as a flight surgeon, providing health care for the astronauts and their families. It really was a dream come true. But in many ways, my identity was not as a follower of Jesus Christ, but my identity had become, I'm a flight surgeon working for NASA. I really didn't think that I would leave NASA. God said, you need to make a choice. It was in our living room. I was saying to God, this job is cool, but I don't need it. I need you. Whatever you want to do, I'm ready.
When he finally came to me and told me that this is what he felt called to do, I just said, I've been waiting.
God moved us to the country of Uganda, where we served for 12 and a half years. From there, moved south to Lesotho. And then God brought us to Kigoma Baptist Hospital, where we've been serving for the last 7 years. In western Tanzania, it literally is at the end of the road because we're right on the Lake Tanganyika. God has placed us in an area that is predominantly Islamic. Healthcare in our part of the world, there is a great limitation on resources that are available. We have patients that are admitted with severe malaria, dysentery. Every year we have an outbreak of cholera. We don't have the adequate numbers of resources and personnel on the field to be able to meet all the needs.
But we have partnerships with a number of different churches and on various levels.
When a church comes in and partners with us to provide that kind of care, it literally changes the people's lives, both physically but also spiritually. Using healthcare strategies is like a key that opens the door to get into a village that we might not have access to. Not far outside of the town that we live in is a small village.
Completely unreached on the fringes of town.
We met with local leaders and we asked permission to come to that village and do a week-long medical dental eye clinic. Through that opportunity, God used that to start a new church plant.
That village has been a huge impact.
growing in their faith in Jesus Christ and being discipled. Just this past week, one person came and repented and said, no, I need this Jesus. The kingdom of light is coming in Tanzania, bursting through the darkness like we've never seen before.
The Lottie Moon offering. 100% of those funds go for us to place people in the field in support of our missionaries. The prayer guide this week asks us to pray for IMB workers and their field partners in East Asia to impact lostness by reaching and mobilizing Asian university students. And the second request was pray for God to raise up more workers and prompt churches to be generous in supporting them. That's us. You saw the video. God called that doctor to leave his position with NASA and go to the field and serve him. That was God's call upon his life. What is God calling you to do? To be. Is your identity in your work, or is your identity anchored in the one whose birth we celebrate during this magnificent season? Let's pray. Father, we bow our heads before you this morning. God, thankful that you've brought us here safely. Thankful that the weather did not get in the way of our worship and our experience this morning as we come together in this sanctuary. And Father, we pray for our workers, our thousands of workers scattered across the world, our missionaries, the support teams, our partners. God, that you would supernaturally empower them to penetrate the darkness and the lostness of every place in which they find themselves serving. And God, we pray, as the request has come, that indeed we would be sensitive to your call, that we would be willing to go wherever it is you would want to send us. And God, there may be someone here this morning, someone that you're dealing with at a deeply, intensely personal level. And maybe they're unsettled with where they are in life. And God, maybe you're calling them to go. Some of us have been there. God, speak clearly. Remind each of us that you are still in the business of calling and sending us from every church to serve every nation. In the name of Christ, we come in prayer. We welcome you this morning. If you're a guest of our church, and I know some of you are, we are so thankful that you've come to join us. This is the morning of our choir special entitled All Is Well. And if you're here this morning, God's brought you here as a guest. We pray that this would truly be a celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ.
It's Christmas, and all around the world there are warm, inviting fires burning on brightly decorated hearths. Families are gathered around magnificently adorned evergreens, exchanging gifts given in love. The splendid fragrance of Christmas cooking mixes with the sounds of Christmas carols to create this glorious holiday scene. Peace seems to dwell here, and hope, and even joy. Although we all long for this picture-perfect scene at this time of year, reality reminds us that not everyone experiences this same depiction of the holidays. Many are alone, limited on resources, and unable to find a reason. How can joy abide when there is so much need, so much hurt, so many problems? For the answer, we must start back in history to a time and place when the whole world was waiting for a peacemaker, a deliverer, a savior. Angels. They were the first bearers of the news that the Messiah had come, and those who heard the news first and believed it were among the lowliest citizens in the land. Shepherds, hired hands to watch, feed, and protect someone else's sheep. But they enthusiastically received the message just the same, and immediately ran to find the newborn king lying in a manger.
Thank you.
God and sinners would finally be reconciled. Peace on earth would come through heaven's child, and his peace would not be fragile as the world might experience it. Jesus, our Savior, would be the one to bring peace that passes human understanding. It is the peace that only God himself can provide. From hearts that are at peace with God, hope can spring up. Hope, it is the certainty that what God has done in the past, he will continue to do forever. And to think it first appeared in the flesh one night in ancient Bethlehem.
Oh,
That was a night like no other night in the history of the world. The angels brought the announcement. Good news of great joy for all the people. News that would change the direction of the world, and news that would transform the lives of untold numbers to come. For today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born unto you. He is Christ the Lord. The prophet Isaiah, hundreds of years before, tells us that the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. The words of the prophet Isaiah, the Christmas message that on those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Notice here that it does not say, the Bible does not say, that from the world a light has come, but upon the world a light has dawned. Christ alone, then, brothers and sisters, is the light we lack. Christ alone is the light that we cannot generate ourselves. Every morning when I take my puppy out for a walk, I grab my flashlight that I will try not to shine in anybody's eyes directly. And this light keeps me out of trouble in there in the darkness. But Christ coming on that old holy night is not like shining a man-made light that's even as bright as it is, just illuminates a path for me. This was a light for all in the world to experience and see. It was a divine light for the whole world to witness. How can that be? The best known verses of this chapter in Isaiah, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. The text tells us clearly, unto us, that's you, and that's me, for unto us, all who are gathered here, a child is born. And the child brings what Isaiah describes as characteristics, as a wonderful counselor, as the mighty God who came to earth, the everlasting Father and the Prince of Peace. It's remarkable that these four titles applied to this child belong to God and God alone. He's the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father, which means that he is our creator. And yet he was born on this earth on that night. Scholars note that none other of the world's religions make such a claim. I love it that Isaiah tells us that he is a wonderful counselor. Why is he called a counselor? When you're going through something hard, when I'm going through something hard, that's very difficult perhaps, it's good to talk with someone who's been where you are at that moment, who's been there before you, one who has personally known what you're going through. As wonderful counselor, brothers and sisters, Jesus counsels us as one who became one of us. In our human condition, in all of our challenges and problems and aches and pains and heartaches and heartbreaks, in our sin, he became one of us in order to know that which we endure. And the baby whose birth we celebrate this morning saved us by going to the cross on our behalf. He went there freely of his own will. He went there out of sheer, unmistakable, never seen before love. And that's beautiful. What a thought as we hear of this holy night. That he died for us, for our sins, is the reason that we are called as followers of Christ to obey him. Not simply because we have to, but because we love him as well. Because we want to obey him. The light that he is and all that he has done for us. And he is wonderful as the divine light of the world. This light becomes ours, yours, and mine. It's a gift. And it can be ours only if we are willing to receive that light as a gift of God's grace. When I think about the words of O Holy Night, how the message of Christmas and the music of Christmas conveys the message of Christ. But many of our Christmas favorite songs don't tell the rest of the story of the life of Jesus. Isaiah later said that he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. When Jesus went to the cross, he paid the penalty for your sin and for mine. And when we trust in Christ's work on our behalf, rather than our own feeble efforts, God forgives us and accepts us and implants his Holy Spirit within us to renew us from the inside out. This great salvation that is available to all who will receive through faith by grace this light that flashes upon us with all its newness and truth and beauty. And it comes to you and comes to me as a gift. And the only way you and I can receive it is to admit that it's an undeserved grace. That nothing we can do on our own can earn it. It's grace. Christmas is about receiving presents, and we enjoy that. But sometimes it's difficult to receive certain gifts. Tim Keller writes this. He says, some gifts by their very nature make you swallow your pride. Imagine opening a present on Christmas morning from a friend, and it's a book on dieting. And then you take out another ribbon and wrapper, and you find that it's another book from another friend, Overcoming Selfishness. Well, you begin to get a message. And in your pride, you may not want to receive the gift that has been given you. And you say, thank you so much, but you sit there perplexed, wondering, what kind of message are they trying to send me? In other words, some gifts are hard to receive. Because to do so is to admit that we have flaws and weaknesses and sin that pervades our lives. There's never been a gift ever offered that requires us to swallow our pride more so than the gift of Jesus Christ and the salvation that is available only through him. To recognize beyond a shadow of a doubt, once and for all, that there is nothing in us that earns the gift of life, whose birth we celebrate this morning. So here's the message this morning, brothers and sisters. To accept the true Christmas gift, you have to admit that you're a sinner and that you need to be saved by grace, that you need to give up control of your life to Christ. And that is often descending lower than any of us really wants to go. And yet the greatness of the one whose birth we celebrate today is to see how far down he came to prove his love for us. He descended into greatness, if you will. And the Bible says that it's only through repentance that you and I come into his light. So on this O Holy Night that the choir just presented, Christ came down. God came down from the depths of absolute being into time and space on this earth. He came down into humanity, down to the very roots and nature that he had created. So he comes down to us during this season. He comes down to go up again and bring the whole messed up world with him. The light of the world descended into darkness in order to bring us into the beautiful light of God. So it's important to remember on this morning, in which we are blessed to be here. We take it for granted, but it bears mentioning. The birth of Christ really happened. This is not merely a story that brings with it sentiment and makes us feel good. No, no, no. The birth of Jesus Christ is real. And if we are saved by our own efforts rather than faith in Christ, then stories about Jesus have but one function, and that's just to kind of make us feel good at Christmas. To inspire us to imitate him and to follow his example. If that's the case, it doesn't matter whether the stories are true or not. It doesn't matter whether they're fiction or true. What's important is they give us examples to live by. If that's what you believe, it's just story. But if you and I are saved by grace, not by what we do and not by what he has done, then it's crucial that the great events of the gospel story, the incarnation, the atonement on the cross, his resurrection from the dead, it's important for us to remember that these events actually occurred at a time and in a place. John himself says words we know. We saw him with our own eyes. We heard him with our ears. We touched him with our hands. Robert Yarbrough, a New Testament scholar, say that the verbs in these texts correspond to witnesses in ancient jurisprudence. And so when John writes to you and to me, he said, we've seen it and we testify to it. Then he speaks of hearing, seeing, and touching. He's not making mere conversation. He's giving legal testimony. A deposition of sorts. This is court language. John is saying this is not just a set of nice stories. There were many others who were witnesses with me. We testify to it. We really saw him. He really lived. He really died. And he really rose from the grave. The light has dawned, brothers and sisters. It's come from the outside. That night, the birth of our Savior Jesus Christ. He brought that light to save us. And not only us, but all the world. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So this morning, the words of the angels bring you good news of great joy for all the people. For unto us this day is born a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And he is indeed the hope of the world, the hope of the nations.
A thrill of hope to a weary world, but it would not just go to God's chosen people, Israel. It would extend to us all, to every nation, to every tribe, to every heart that would make room for this gift of hope.
Jesus,
Let me invite our ushers to come forward as we prepare for our offertory this morning. Father, our hearts are filled with wonder and awe. God, even as the choir presents so powerfully in song, God, we believe that you are indeed the hope of the world. And Father, these monies that we give this morning, may they truly be used to spread the good news of great joy for all the people to the uttermost parts of the earth, and even in the video as we saw, every church, every nation. God, we ask your blessing upon all that is received this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Where does your hope come? From jobs, possessions, friends, family? If these are your only sources of hope, you will probably be surprised how temporary these things can be. Jobs and possessions can be lost in an instant. Friends, even family, can fade away over time. The only sure foundation, our only true hope, is in God the Father. And by trusting in Christ, His Son, we can know that all things will work together for our good. This is our hope. Thank you.
All is well. Is all is well? Is all well in your life this morning? Are you certain? Are you sure about your relationship with the one who was born in that beautiful setting 2,000 years ago? Is your faith in Christ and Christ alone? If you're here this morning and maybe all is not quite well in your life, in a moment we're going to sing a hymn of response. It's a missions hymn. It's fitting on a Lottie Moon Sunday. It's called Shine, Jesus, Shine. Speaks of the light of Christ shining here in this place in Campbellsville, Taylor County, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. But it begins right here. So we're going to sing a great hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine. We're going to stand in just a moment. This is a time for you to respond to the good news of Jesus Christ. It's a time for all of us to celebrate what God is doing here and to the ends of the earth. I'm going to pray, then we'll stand and we're going to sing together. And the choir's not quite done yet, nor is the orchestra. Father, we bow our heads before you. Father, as we prepare to sing a great hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Father, we pray that every one of us, before we leave this place today, would have the absolute certainty that through our faith in Jesus Christ, all is well. Father, we pray that Campbellsville Baptist Church, this congregation, that we would embrace the challenge and the mission that you have entrusted to us, to take the light of Christ into the darkness of this world. And it's in His name we come before you in prayer. Amen. Let's stand, church, as we sing together.
Shine on,
a moment. I would be remiss, and we would be remiss as a church, if we did not extend our gratitude on this morning to all of the musicians that have gathered, narration, the tech team in the top that does not ever need to be forgotten, for the work that they do week after week after week, the orchestra, the choir. It was a team effort, and we should be deeply appreciative. And one that I don't want to overlook, who is sitting right in front of me, that dodges the limelight, but Jen Tennell, how grateful we are for you to be willing to give so much of yourself to make this happen. We deeply appreciate it. And I mean it sincerely. It's a joy to work with you. All right, we're going to go forth from this place. We're going to do one more, and we invite you to stand and sing along with the choir and the musicians. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Aren't you glad you came to church today? Amen. 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 Amen.